It starts with, "In the name of Allah, the infinitely compassionate and most merciful," which means that the basic rule to reading the Quran and whatever knowledge we want to acquire is first to purify our intentions. And our intention should be that we read this in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should seek knowledge in this Quran for God's sake, in His name. It means we should not read it that we may find errors or so that we may laugh at it. But our intention first should be to read it in the name of Allah with hope to find truth. This is the only way when Allah guides a person. A person with the pure intention to find truth of his own existence and the existence of God. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains His attributes. He is extremely merciful, so there's nothing to fear from Him. We should love Him because He is more merciful with us than we can ever imagine. This is explained after in the Quran.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Welcome back to Reflections. I'm your host, Imam Suhaib Webb. It's always great to be with you here talking about this incredible book, the Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We stopped at this beautiful verse, Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in, such a well of guidance for people who think about it and sit and just ask themselves the meaning of ibadah and isti'ana, worshiping Allah and seeking His aid. This verse is so powerful that once in America, when I was memorizing the Quran at a local Quranic school in Oklahoma, we had a neighbor who was an agnostic. And he came one day to the mosque because our teacher gave him a Quran as a gift. And he came and he was really visibly upset, almost to the point of tears. And he said to our teacher, he said, "You know, my entire life I believed in God, but I was never able to really express my feelings towards Him until I read your book and I came across this one verse in your Quran." And he pointed to the verse, "Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in." And he said, "You know what? This is what I've always wanted to say to the Creator and never been able to say it. This is always what I wanted to express to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but I just didn't have the ability to express it. And you gave me this book and you gave me the gift of these beautiful words." Imagine, this is an agnostic. What about those of us who have this beautiful verse in front of us, "Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in," our entire lives? Have we given it as much of investment as this agnostic man, he did? Let's take a few moments to look at the verse, and I'm going to draw some things for you on the board, which I really think will help you to engage this verse in another way and really bring about the beauty of this verse. The verse actually begins, interestingly enough, with an object. And in Arabic, you can actually place the object in front of a verb, and we'll talk about why in a minute. And it continues doing the same thing. It brings an object first, and then it ends with a verb. This is the object, Iyyaka. And what that means is you, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the verb here is actually the incomplete tense, which is called فعل مضارع in Arabic, which means we worship. So you can see here, what's pretty cool is that you, the object, comes before the verb worship. So the object you actually comes in front of the sentence, which is very interesting, because if you're going to write it maybe on your own, or I was going to write it in Arabic, we would say na'budu ka. We would put the object here, which means you, of course. We worship. So here the meaning of the sentence is we worship you. So maybe you're going to ask, why this interesting structure where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran to have the object in front of the verb? Secondly, why is this an incomplete tense? Why is it فعل مضارع? فعل مضارع means a tense which is incomplete. What we mean by incomplete is that we don't know when it's going to stop. It's not a past tense verb, it's a present future verb. Two reasons why. If we say na'buduk, we worship you, that implies that we might worship something else along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the object comes after the verb, it implies that that object could share also. When that object comes after the verb, it could imply that that object is also sharing with other things. But in Arabic, and this is called hasar, when the object is put in front of the verb, it means that that object is the sole recipient of the action that that verb implies. So it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only object, the only one worthy, the only one who has the right for us to worship. The only one who receives the worship of the Muslims is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why iyyaka, the object, is put in front of the verb na'budu. Secondly, na'budu, as I mentioned before, and I want you to remember this because this is going to come up on a number of occasions as we continue our reflection with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is called in Arabic fi'l mudari', which means the present future tense. Fi'l mudari', the present future tense, implying that it doesn't end. And this actually in Arabic rhetoric is a form of praising someone or shaming someone. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the believers, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ, those who believe and will believe in the unseen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't mention when that faith will stop. That's a praise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he talks about Abu Jahl, he says, أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يَنْهَى, have you not seen the one who rebukes and will continue to rebuke the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Not only is that a way of shaming Abu Jahl, but it's also a prophecy implying that Abu Jahl will never become Muslim. Here, the beauty behind na'budu is that it means those people who claim to be Muslims, those people who say la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and those people who are sincere in their belief, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that they will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they will continue to worship Him alone until the end of time. And this is called istiqama, istiqama. So the ulama said that one of the fruits of iyyaka na'budu is that someone, وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ, someone will spend their life in the ibadah of Allah alone exclusively. Also, iyyaka nasta'een, you alone, nasta'een, we seek assistance from. This also implies that the entire life of the Muslim is going to be used to invest everything in this dunya, everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them in this dunya to serve and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can you imagine, subhanallah, this is the meaning of iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. And what that implies is that the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the worship of Allah, is exclusive in our lives. Also, iyyaka nasta'in implies that everything that we do in this life, all of it can be used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Imam al-Haramain said that with a good intention, even raising your children, spending time with your wife, going to the park, investing in your community, being clean, going to school, being a fashion designer, being a video game programmer, all of these things can serve as acts of worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if the intention is correct. That's the meaning of iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Such a beautiful, profound statement that forms the crux and the anchor of the life of a Muslim. Because the life of a Muslim is between two things, ibadah and isti'anah. قُلْ هُوَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَآمَنَّا بِهِ وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا. We find this formula mentioned over and over in the Qur'an. Say, He is Ar-Rahman, we believe in and we trust. We'll continue shortly talking about this important surah and the gateway to the Qur'an. You're watching Reflections with Imam Suhaib Webb. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.